Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, we're grateful to be in your house, God. How good it is to be in your presence, Lord. Thank you for the touches, God, that have already taken place at this altar. Many touched in their seats as well, God. Thank you, Lord, for healings. Thank you, God, for words of wisdom and provision, God. Things that have already taken place, God, books could be written about what you've already done in just a few moments, God. Lord, we don't want to stop there. We want to go farther with you. We want to go deeper, God. We want your word to come and to illuminate our lives, God. Your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. So tonight, as we open your word, God, open it up to us and open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have the good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Truly tonight, it's not a man or a woman, the young or the old, the black, the white, or the brown, any other color we could imagine. It's not about us hearing from the ideas and the philosophies of man. But God, we're here to hear from you. We acknowledge that the Holy Spirit is the true teacher of the church. So welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, the motivation, even the correction and the discipline we need for our lives. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all of our brothers and sisters, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, they're our brothers and sisters, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else. But we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom, God, so we'd ask that you bless them. And Lord, we don't want to forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad. God, we ask that you strengthen them, encourage them, protect them, provide for them, God. Deliver them, Lord. And we thank you, Father, that they endure to the end, to the praise and glory of God. Lord, it's in Jesus' mighty name we all say, amen. Amen. You can have a seat tonight. Get your Bibles out. Go with me to Romans chapter number 6. And whenever I minister Wednesday nights or as we finish up some of the series, maybe on Sunday nights, I'll be ministering different parts of this, but each message will stand alone. And this is distractions from destiny. This will be part number one. And in our lives, we are headed in a direction. God has a divine destiny for our lives. There are things that can get us off of destiny, things that can distract us. I personally, you can ask my wife this, she's currently at home with our three children, getting them ready for school and that sort of thing. She stayed home tonight, she's watching on the live stream. Hi, hon, I love you. But she'll tell you, I'm one of the most easily distracted people that she knows. It's almost like, you know, you hear about those people that see something shiny and all of a sudden their attention is off. That's me, totally. Let me tell you, to illustrate this point, cleaning the house is probably the prime example of how distracted I can get. Let's say I decide, you know what, I'm going to clean this kitchen. This kitchen's a mess. We've eaten dinner. My wife slaved over the hot stove for hours for us, so I'm going to clean the kitchen. So I start cleaning the kitchen. As I'm cleaning the kitchen, wiping down counters, and I find a little rubber bouncy ball from the toy room. Hey, these kids, man, I tell you, they can't clean up anything. So I walk that bouncy ball over to the toy room. Then in the toy room, I say, what have these kids been doing? They need to clean up this mess. And I start picking up papers. And as I'm picking up papers and things, I say, well, this is their schoolwork. And I take the schoolwork over, and I find it in the office, and I find their backpacks, and I start putting things in their backpacks. And then in their backpacks, I realize they had a note for me to sign. What are they doing? You know, so I start signing notes and putting it back. And then I say, where was I? What was I doing? Oh, I was cleaning the kitchen, right? So I go back to the kitchen. On my way to the kitchen, I'll find something from my bedroom, and I'll say, well, I can't go clean. I need to see, distracted, right? I'm all over the place. How many of you know it would take me 3 days just to clean the kitchen at that pace? There are things that can attach themselves to our thinking, to our lives, things that will get us off of our divine destiny. To further illustrate this point, just yesterday, my wife and I, we had a couple of goals in mind. We wanted to work out. We wanted to do something physical, some exercise, okay? We wanted to have some time together to just stare in each other's eyes and complete sentences, you know, without being interrupted, that sort of thing, with kids and work and all that kind of stuff. So we wanted to spend some time together, and we knew we needed to go grocery shopping. Those were the three things that we wanted to accomplish yesterday. So after a long argument over what sort of exercise we were going to do, whether we were going to go on a hike or whether we were going to go to the gym or whether we were going to go for a walk. You know, we decided to go for a walk, and then we couldn't find the dog's leash, and then, you know, we're doing all this stuff, and finally we just said, listen, we're just going to go, and we're just going to go up to the mountains. We're just going to go on a little hike, nothing big, you know, maybe a mile hike. And so we decided to go on this place in Big Bear. Now, we drive all the way up, and some of you guys live up here, so you know what I'm about to say, okay? We drive all the way up, you know, from the 10 to the 210 to the 330, we're going up, and as we go up, we hit right about, what's that, Snow Valley or whatever that first ski resort is? Yeah, and it's closed. And my wife and I both are going, well, wait a second. It's closed. What's going on here? How can they just close a whole road in? Man, I wish we would have known about this. See, we had checked the weather conditions. We had checked the trail conditions. We checked everything. We didn't check the road conditions. And so we're saying, well, they should have had signs. As we turned around and we're driving back, there's a sign. We get a little further, there's a sign. We get a little further, there's a sign. Just this morning, I was driving towards the church here, and I saw up on one of those big billboards, you know, do not drive up, closed at Snow Valley. I'm going, oh my gosh, it was right there. You know, I could have known. That way, maybe we could have gone up the back way or something and actually done what we wanted to do there. So we go back and we have some lunch and we found a little hike that we did and we enjoyed that time. We went and we sat down, we stared in each other's eyes, we completed sentences. Then we start to come down. Now, we didn't come back down the way we came. We decided we'll go back down 18, you know, come down Waterman. Now, as we're going down, we didn't realize that between where we were at and between Highway 18, there was road construction there too. And so we sat for like a half an hour waiting for this one-lane road to open up so that all the line of cars that we were in could start heading down the hill. See, there was distractions everywhere. There was stuff that stopped. And so we came down the hill. I went and picked up kids, went grocery shopping, all that kind of stuff. Now listen, our day still got done. The three things that we wanted to accomplish still got accomplished. Even though it didn't get done maybe the way that we would have liked it, and it didn't wasn't as neat and as clean as we would like it to be, we still were able to accomplish our goals. See, oftentimes in life, we think that because things maybe take longer, there's delays, there's distractions, there's things, bumps along the road, that we're not going to get to where we want to go. And yet, if we will stay focused, and if we will stay after it, if we will follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, follow the Word of God, the will of God, listen, the way of God, we will make it to our divine destiny. God will make sure, because God watches after His Word. He cannot go back on it. He will perform it, because if He didn't perform it, He would be a liar, and then He'd have to give up His throne. So God is looking after His Word, and if we will stay focused on the Lord, if we will go in His direction, and if we will not allow distractions to get us off purpose and off course, then we'll make it to where we need to go. Is anybody listening today? Now, the first distraction that I want to talk about tonight, and really the only distraction that I'm going to talk about, and I'm going to talk about how to deal with it, is sin. Sin is a distraction from destiny. Each and every one of us in this room, everybody listening to this, we all deal with sin. Only one who is without sin, his name is what? Jesus. That's right, the perfect Sunday school answer, what lives in the forest and is hairy and brown, right? Jesus. Okay? That's a joke, by the way. That's a joke, okay? Thank you for that one laugh. That was great. Rest of you guys, I'm watching you. But sin is a distraction from destiny. If we continue in sin, unrepentant, it not only will distract us from our destiny, but eventually will derail us from our destiny. I can prove that to you in the Word all day, every day. The examples abound. How about King Saul, right? First king of Israel. God wanted to set up His throne. God wanted to set up His kingdom. And yet, because Saul got distracted from his divine destiny, he had specific orders that he was to carry out, specific things that he was supposed to do, and yet he listened to the voice of the people rather than to the voice of God. And when he was confronted by the prophet, he said, wait, I've done what God asked me to do. And the prophet said, well, wait a second. If you've done what God has asked you to do, why do I still hear the bleating of sheep in my ear when they should all be dead? And he says, to rebel is as the sin of witchcraft. He says, does God delight in sacrifice and burnt offering as much as He does in obedience? See, sin will distract us, but eventually, if we stay unrepentant in sin, it will derail us. Now, Saul grabs a hold of the prophet's cloak, and it rips it from him. And the prophet turns around and says, so also has God torn the kingdom from you. And he says, wait a second, I want you to honor me in the sight of the people and come back with me and worship with me. See, his heart wasn't right in the matter. It wasn't about honoring God anymore. It was about his honor. Sin took him off of his purpose. How about Ananias and Sapphira, right? New Testament. Let's go to the New Testament. Sometimes people say, well, God was angry in the Old Testament, but the New Testament, he's lovey-dovey, kissy-kissy, right? Well, tell me about that story in the New Testament. After the resurrection, right? After the Holy Ghost comes. Here comes two people. The church is coming together. They're sharing all the gifts that they have. Here comes Barnabas, the son of encouragement. This guy's cool, right? He comes, he sells the property, he lays down all the money of the disciples' feet, says, whatever you guys need to do, here you go. Now, Ananias and Sapphira, the very next thing you see is that they also sold a piece of property. It's almost as if they saw what was going on and they said, well, that's cool. And we like how encouraged everybody is by that. And we could do that. But you know what? We want to keep back part of this profit, but we're not going to tell anybody. And they conspired together to lie. And so they come in and they lay it down. And here's Ananias. He lays it down at the disciples' feet. And the apostle Peter says, well, wait a second. Is this how much you got? Is this the price that you sold the land for? And he says, yeah, that's the price. Bang, falls over dead. His wife comes in. Young man had just carried her husband out. Peter says, Sapphira, is this how much you guys sold the property for? She says, yeah, it is. He says, the feet of the young man that just carried your husband out are now here at the door to carry you out. Bang, she falls over dead. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. See, they allowed a lie. As Peter said, you haven't lied to man, but you've lied to the Holy Spirit. So serious. See, sin derailed them from their destiny. They could have been like Barnabas. They could have been an encouragement. They could have said, hey, you know what? We sold a piece of property. We're going to keep this for our retirement, but you all can have this. There's no problem with that. Why? Because it's honest, it's open, and everyone would have said, thank you, that's cool, you guys are awesome. And yet, because they lied, here they are, they fall over dead. See, we can't allow sin to continue in our life because it will derail us from our destiny. But in our lives, if we stay focused on God, we will encounter sin, we will battle sin, we will struggle with it, there will be times that we will fall into it, or we will walk into it, either way you want to think about it. And we're going to have to deal with it. So how do we deal with it? How do we deal with it? A couple of things tonight to deal with the distraction of sin. First one is this, is look for the signs and the boundary lines. I made it rhyme so that you would remember it. Is that cool? Look for the signs and the boundary lines. Everybody say that with me. Look for the signs and the boundary lines. See, in our society, we like to push the boundary lines. We like to move the stones, the ancient stones. We like to test the limits. We like to walk the line. And yet, as Christians, sometimes we wonder, well, wait a second, hasn't Christ set us free? Can't we do whatever we want? And the answer is absolutely, you could do whatever you want. The Bible says everything is permissible, but guess what? Not everything is profitable. Not everything is beneficial. And in the same way, I'm going to show you a section of scripture. I had you turn with me to Romans chapter 6. And in the New Testament, these are epistles, letters to the church that are under the dispensation of grace. In fact, the revelation of grace is contained in it. And even in that, you will find signs and guardrails, boundary lines that we as Christians need to look at because sin was not okay under the law, but guess what? Sin is still not okay under grace. Are you listening tonight? Let's read it together. Romans, the 6th chapter, verse number 11, starting out. Speaking of the struggle that we face with sin. Romans, let me get there. The 6th chapter, starting in verse number 11, he's just talked about how Jesus Christ died, and he died to sin, and yet he lives again unto God. So he says, likewise, so just as Christ died and was raised again, likewise, you also reckon yourselves or account yourself or consider yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Verse 12, therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey its lust. Now, I want you to notice something up on the overheads. Do not let. That means that it's a choice. We can either let it reign. We can either let it have its full play in the yard, right? Sin, go ahead. Do what you want to do. Or we cannot let it reign in our mortal body, that we should obey its lust. Verse number 13. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. So we have a choice every day to either present our members as instruments of sin, or we can present ourselves to God as instruments of righteousness. The choice is ours. We either let it reign or we let God reign. Are you listening? We either make those choices for ourselves or we make decisions based on the word of God. Look at the next verse. Verse 14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law but under grace. Remember, you died to sin. You're no longer under the law. You died to that. Now you're under grace, the ability of God on our behalf when we can't do it, right? We couldn't save ourselves. God saved us. In the same way, in the flesh and the natural, there's a war going on. And so we are now under grace, the ability of God. We have all the tools we need to overcome. Let me say that again. We have all the tools we need to overcome. We have the grace of God. We have the way of escape that God provides with the temptation of sin. We have Jesus Christ. We have the Word of God that overcomes. We have our faith, right? We have every tool at our disposal. And yet, oftentimes we find ourselves in a place where we're going, why am I still struggling this? Why am I doing this? What's going on here, God? God, I thought I was delivered. God, what's happening? And then we read sections of scripture and we wonder, man, am I even saved? Let's read on. Sin shall not have dominion over you, for you're not under law, but under grace. Verse 15, what then? Shall we sin because we're not under law, but under grace? Certainly not. He says, should we just dive in because, hey, you know what? It's all covered by the blood. We're now not under law, we're under grace now. No, he says we should not. Now look at the next verse. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one slaves whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness. See, God has given us freedom from sin. We used to be locked in a cage. We used to be bound by every lust, by every distraction, by every sin, by every filthy thing. We used to be in that place. But now God has come and he has purchased us. He has bought us out of that slavery. Now we've died to that old man. We are no longer bound. And now we are free. But we are free to what? Remember, we're sheep, right? We're Jesus' sheep. He's the great shepherd. How many of you know that a shepherd keeps his sheep close to himself? If a sheep starts wandering off, what will he do? He'll take his crook and he will pull them back close to him. Why? Because there's safety there. If he sees a sheep wandering off towards a cliff, what's he going to do? He's going to go get that sheep and turn them around. And at night when they lay down, what does he do? He creates a sheepfold. He builds a wall. Why? Because there's protection in that place. See, I don't think we understand with our thinking of freedom, with our thinking in American society, from our history, where we've come from and where we're going, we don't understand that there are freedom in the boundary lines. Can I say that again? There's freedom in the boundary lines. You can go wherever you want to go inside those boundary lines. You can do whatever you want to do inside those boundary lines. There are rules of the game. You know, we understand this in sports, right? You go outside of the line, what have you done? You went outside the boundary lines. You messed up, right? But if you play according to the rules and you play inside the boundary lines, you're okay. You can run, you can play, you can score the goal, you can do that. We get that. But then when someone tells us you shouldn't do that, we say, well, wait a second, but I'm free. Isn't that right? And yet God has not set these boundary lines in our life. See, we got to look for the signs. I remember there was a time where, my wife will love this illustration. There was a girl in high school, okay? It was not my wife, it was another girl. And she was, looking at me and I was looking at her and we kind of liked each other and so we're hanging out and just high school love, that sort of a thing. And so we were going out and I remember a bunch of friends said, hey, there's this place, we want to go check it out. It's out here and, you know, a bunch of little houses, little cabins, they're all little kid size, it's really cool and this and that. So I said, hey, cool. So we all drive out there. As we're walking up, there's a gate. And there's a hole in the gate. Everybody's passing through the hole in the gate. And so I'm walking up, and I walk up, and I see a sign. No trespassing. Violators will be prosecuted. And I stopped, and I went, whoa, whoa, whoa. Everybody, hold up. Do y'all see the sign? And they say, yeah, it's fine. No one's around. Let's go check it out. No big deal. No one's going to catch us. And I lifted my foot, and I heard God say, don't you disobey me. And I said, whoa, you know, and I was only saved for like a year or two at this point. And so I just, whoa, you know, guys, I'm going to be in the car. I'll see you later. Now, this little girl, this little thing that was looking at me, right? She comes up and she's so mad at me. I don't understand. Why you got to be such a holy roller? Why you got to be such a killjoy? Everybody's having fun. How come you can't come? I said, look, I got to listen to God. I just have to listen to God. I went on a missions trip. When I left, man, it hurt my heart. I was aching. You know, I thought, gosh, why am I leaving? You know, we're kind of checking each other out, this and that. And while I was gone, she went back into the club scene, went back into drinking, all that kind of stuff. I came back, and I remember we were all at a friend's house, and she was about ready to go home. I said, let me give you a ride. So I give her a ride, and I say, what's going on with you? You know, How come I leave, and I'm doing the work of the Lord, and while I'm doing the work of the Lord, you're doing the work of the devil, basically. You know what I mean? I didn't say it like that. I said it nicer, okay? But I heard you going back to the club. What's up with that? You know what she said? You don't know me. It's like, excuse me? You're right, I don't. Now, after we got married, we were up here at a youth camp. Pastor Eddie and Donna, our former youth pastors, were there at the camp. We were newly married, my wife and I, so in love. And we were doing this camp. We were going to come down the hill and fly off to Bible college together. Now, here we are at the camp. And, a bunch of my old friends, the old band, you know, was doing the praise and worship. And so here she comes with all my friends, right? And she comes up, she says, hey, a bunch of us are going out to eat. And right then, my wife, okay, newly married, Jessica, walks up beside me. And I said, oh, hey, this is my wife. You know what I mean? Because it's like, hey, get a picture here, get a clue. Okay? This is my wife. She goes, hi. This girl stood there, looked her up and down, looked at me and said, so you're not going? I could feel my arm starting to do the parent thing when you're in the car and you're screeching the brakes, you're holding back, the heat is radiating off my wife, starting to turn red. She did good. She held her tongue. I said, no, I'm not going. Sometimes at the back door, greeting here at the back door, you know, shaking hands with people, and some thing comes by the door. Oh, Pastor, oh, you're so wonderful. All this hug, you know, let me just give you a hug and pull me in close, all this kind of stuff. And listen, you don't hug a married man like that. Have you met my wife? Right? But there's other times that I'm a little naive, and someone will come through and they're a little too friendly, and my wife will say, mark that one. You know what I say? Yes, ma'am. Why? Guardrails. I see the sign. Because the book of Proverbs tell me that the wayward woman stands and shouts aloud, come into my house, there's food. We can drink of love all night, and my lips are like honey. Guess what else it says? It says her steps lead down to hell. I ain't going. We got to see the signs, church. We cannot allow sin to distract us or derail us from our destiny. Edward R. Lyman said, principle, particularly moral principle, can never be a weather vane spinning around the way, this way and that, with the shifting winds of expediency. Moral principle is a compass forever fixed and forever true. See, our moral compass should always point north, right up to Jesus. Right up to where God is. That's how it should be. In Genesis chapter 39, verse 7 through 9, I'll just put it up on the overheads. You remember the story of Joseph, right? Joseph was being enticed by a woman, Potiphar's wife. She, look at this, Genesis 39, verse 7. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast longing eyes on Joseph. And she said, lie with me. Nobody's around. Joseph's the leader of the house. His master put everything under his authority. He could have gone there. Verse number 8, but he refused. You know what that means? He said, nah. Uh-uh. No. You know, the Bible tells us the grace of God teaches us to say no to ungodliness. The book of Titus. He refused and said to his master's wife, look, my master does not know what is with me in the house, and he has committed all that he has to my hand. Verse 9, there is no one greater in this house than I, nor has he kept back anything from me but you. Now look at what the next statement is. Because you are his wife. In other words, duh. He had a moral compass. This is wrong. Not going there. Now, the last statement is what gets me every time. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? King David, after he committed adultery, said, I've sinned against you and you alone, O Lord. He prayed and he cried out to God, repented of that sin. We have to look for the road signs. We have to see the boundary lines. We've got to watch what we're watching. We've got to be careful, little feet, where you go. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. See, there's more truth to those things that we learned as kids than we actually do know. It helps us. It helps us. Guardrails and guard posts and things that keep us in line. See, we don't want to play on the edge of destruction and sin. We got to stay where God has called us. There's freedom inside the boundary lines. Second thing for tonight is this, live a blameless life. What do I mean by that? See, the first one speaks of sins, you know, mostly internal, mostly, and could involve other people, like adultery does involve other people. But living a blameless life really speaks of our public life, really speaks of who we are out in community, the job site, in our homes. You know, you heard of the guy, I think it was Spurgeon in Letters to His Students, who talked about a man who preached so eloquently in the pulpit, they never wanted him to leave the pulpit, but then he lived so worldly out there in the world, they wanted him never to go back into the pulpit. All right, a couple of you guys got that. But this speaks of the life we live before others. See, just like King Saul lived a life of compromise and it derailed his destiny, his predecessor Samuel, at the end of his life, was speaking to all of Israel. And he said, tell me, whose oxen have I taken? Whose cart have I stolen? Who have I misused or abused? If I've taken anything from anybody right now, I'll pay it back. And you know what they said? They responded to him. They said, you haven't abused or used anyone. You haven't stolen a thing from us. You've been good to us. See, he lived a life that was blameless. It was above reproach. Spurgeon, once again, he says, how can you preach the gospel with your tongues when your hands, feet, and heart, you are preaching the devil's gospel and setting up an antichrist by your practical unholiness? See, we can't come to church and say, oh, bless God, brother, hallelujah, praise the Lord, and then go outside of this place and allow filthy language, allow cheating, allow all sorts of things, cheating on taxes, allow, you know, slipping things under the table. No, don't worry, the boss won't know if we just, let's just cook the books a little bit. See, God's not into that. And those are terrible witnesses out there in the community. Because when they talk about what's going on the weekend, oh, yeah, I went to church. You go to church, excuse me? Remember, I was on the soccer field one time, and a bunch of the dads had to jump in and be coaches, and so we were all working together. And one of the guys was talking about this and that, and he said, well, maybe you should come over to my house. I said, I wouldn't go to your house, man. I wouldn't even go to church with you, if you invited me. You're a terrible person. I thought, whoa, let me back up before the lightning strikes here, you know? See, I don't want to live a life where somebody could say, man, I would never follow you. I see what you do outside of the pulpit. I see what you do outside of church. I want to live a life where people say, what he is in the pulpit is what he is at home. What he is at home is what he's at the store. What he's at the store is what he's out there. Ask my staff. Ask the people that work with me. Ask my family. Go talk to my kids. See, this is about us living a blameless life. The Bible calls it being above reproach. No one can come and bring an accusation against you because they see your life. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 2. I'll put it up once again on the overheads. The Apostle Paul is writing and he says, open your hearts to us. We've wronged no one. We've corrupted no one. We have cheated no one. See, he lived a life that was above reproach. He wouldn't even take money from some of the churches that he went and ministered to so that they wouldn't feel like they were being abused by him. He worked a natural job in order to provide for his support. Our lives should be blameless before our family, before our coworkers, before our neighbors, our friends, and anyone else we encounter. Amen. It's consistency. You know what that word is called? It's called integrity. Yes, yes. Who you are in private is who you are in public. Who you are in the church seat is who you are in the driver's seat. Come on, somebody. Yes. Turn me to the book of Daniel. Book of Daniel. Thank you for that one holy clap. Yes. Hallelujah. I don't want to move because they'll know it's me, Pastor. All right. Daniel chapter 6. Daniel chapter 6. I'm just playing. Listen, we all struggle in many areas, right? I'm not perfect. I'm not preaching down on you. We're all in this together. We're learning how to do life, learning how to battle this issue called sin. Daniel chapter 6. Talk about being above reproach. This man Daniel was a great man. So he committed that he would not defile himself with the king's delicacies. He purposed in his heart, I'm not going into that. That's sin for me. Later on, He's getting a promotion and people get jealous. Daniel chapter 6, verse number 3 and 4. Look at what it says. It says, then Daniel distinguished himself above the governors and satraps because an excellent spirit was in him. And the king gave thought to setting him over the whole realm. Man, this guy Daniel, he worked as unto the Lord. He had an excellent spirit. He did everything. I mean, I could imagine he probably never complained. He probably looked at issues and thought them through, brought solutions. He's probably the kind of guy you wanted on your team. You know, listen, we got a really big project. Let's go get Daniel. He can help us out, right? Now look at the next verse. Verse number 4, so the governors and satraps sought to find some charge against Daniel concerning the kingdom. In other words, they were jealous. They were envious. They did not want Daniel being raised up in their government. They didn't want Daniel being put over them. No. This guy's one of the captives. Why should we want to listen to him? And so they start to rise up their ugly heads and they start to look for a way that they could bring a charge against him. Now look at what it says, concerning the kingdom. In other words, what he did, his work, they were looking for something, trying to dig up some dirt. Look at the rest of the verse. But they could find no charge or fault because he was faithful, nor was there any error or fault found in him. See, politicians like these guys, the governors and the satraps, want to dig up some dirt and start slinging mud. Yet when they looked inside of Daniel, they couldn't find any dirt, and therefore they couldn't sling any mud. Here's a man who distinguished himself. He lived a life that was blameless. If we're going to keep away from the distraction of sin, we got to live a blameless life. We got to be careful. We got to make sure that our I's are dotted, our T's are crossed. If you make a mistake on the job, go talk to your boss about it. Fess up. They will appreciate that more than if you try and sweep it under the rug. All right? It's all good. The Lord will protect you. All right? So first thing is this, look for the signs and the boundary lines. Second one is live a blameless life. Last one is this, confess and forsake sin. Just deal with it. Deal with sin. We're all going to have times in our life that we mess up. Sin, part of the definition is missing the mark. We're going to miss the mark. Why? Because we still live in these flesh bodies. Because there's still a war and a battle that goes on. And we don't always walk in the spirit. Sometimes we choose to live in the flesh. We allow the mind to get linked up with the flesh. A couple of weeks ago, Pastor Jim taught a message on maturity on a Wednesday. And I would encourage you, get a hold of that as well. How to control the flesh. Because when your spirit links up with your mind, you will control the flesh. But if your mind keeps linking up with your flesh, then the flesh is going to rule. You're going to end up in sin. You're going to miss the mark or you're going to trespass. You're going to see the hole in the fence, you're going to see the sign, and you're going to walk through anyways. It happens. We know it. So what do? When we're distracted by sin and when it threatens to derail us from destiny, here's what we do. We confess it and we forsake it. Plain and simple. Look at what the Bible says. Proverbs 28:13. He who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. That's a promise from God. Oh my goodness, there have been times in my life I've gone to God with knees knocking. Lord, I messed up royally this time, God. I don't know how you could forgive me. And can I tell you something? It's good to feel bad about when you sin. If you're sinning and you don't feel bad, something's wrong. Your conscience has been seared. And you need to go get with the Holy Spirit, get with the Word of God. You need to go and you need to spend some time on your face before the Lord and say, God, I don't even feel bad. God, come and take this. God, tenderize me. God, soften my heart. Go, like the book of James says, weep and wail. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. We need to go to the fountain of living water. We need to go to the spring of life. We need to go to the blood. This is the only blood that when you wash in it, you come out cleansed. It's supernatural. And you allow that cleansing flow to cover the sin, but you have to confess it. You have to say, God, I was wrong. God, I'm sorry. God, please forgive me. And then forsake it. You know what forsake it means? Think about it this way. God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. It means God will never leave you alone, hung out to dry. But if we're going to forsake our sin, we need to leave it alone and hang it out to dry. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. We need to confess it. And then we need to forsake it. Like Jesus said, he said, if your right hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. If your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. What is he talking about? Actually cutting your hand off? No, he's talking about getting rid of those things that would cause you to stumble. Like a man went to the doctor and said, Doctor, I broke my arm in two places. He says, stay out of them places. God knows where we live, and he knows the battles we fight. Knows, and he's given us the tools to overcome. When we sin, when we do sin, we need to deal with it. Get focused again on our destiny as Christians and children of God. 1 John chapter 1, turn there with me. Very familiar verses. I want to read them to you with this understanding. This is a tool in your life to help you deal with sin, because we all struggle, and there's going to be times where we sin. This is how you deal with sin as a Christian. 1 John chapter 1, I'm going to start in verse number 7. Very important that we understand this. Look at what it says. It says, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light. Remember, Jesus said, your word is truth. The Bible tells us in the book of Psalms, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. So if we walk in light of God's word, his truth, as he is in the light, look at this, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. See, when you've given your heart and life to Jesus, you have been forgiven. You've been freed from the bondage, and you've been cleansed from past, present, and future sins. There's going to be something that happens in your life as a Christian. You're going to go through problems. You're going to go through trials. Look at the next verse. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. So we can't say, I'm not dealing with anything in the flesh. Because if we say we have no sin, hey, you're still living in this flesh body, and as long as you've got this, there's a battle. There's a war that's raging. Now look at verse number 9. If we confess our sins. See, you've been cleansed, right? But now as things happen in life, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. As you are aware of your sin and you realize you've messed up, you've missed the mark, or you have walked past the boundary line, you confess it. Bring it to the Lord. God, I messed up. God, this is what I did. God, please forgive me. And look at what the Bible says. He is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God says, as far as the east is from the west, I have cast your sin from you. Sometimes we hold on to it. God, I got to beat myself up over my sin. No, you got to bring your sin to God. Allow him to purge it from you and to cleanse you of that sin. And then work at it. Work hard at it. Struggle against it. Strive against it. Put boundary lines. If you have to cut something off, cut it off. But you don't have to be afraid of it. You don't have to be afraid of sin. Jesus dealt with sin on the cross. So we don't have to be afraid of sin. Sometimes we're so afraid and we get under such condemnation. God, I struggle, and God, I'm struggling. God is saying, bring it to me, confess it, and then let's work this out in your life together. The grace of God will come in and God will empower you. God will show you when you're tempted. He will show you the way of escape. We just got to take it. Or how about this? Stop before you put your foot over the line. See, we have all the tools we need. God has given it to us in his word. And should we enter into sin, man, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and his blood cleanses us from sin. We got to confess it, and then we got to forsake it. Do your part to stay out of sin. What did we learn tonight? Distractions from destiny. First one is this: sin is a distraction from destiny. Number one, look for the signs and the boundary lines. Second thing is this: we said that we are to live a blameless life, not only internally, but externally, wherever we're at, that's called integrity. And finally, confess and forsake sin. Can you guys give the Lord a praise tonight? Hallelujah. I want to talk to some of you guys before you leave this place as well. A bunch of people got up, even though I asked two times very nice not to get up. And so they still got up. Little rascals are out there in the foyer. And I've got speakers out there. So if you guys can hear the sound of my voice, why don't you guys stop? Grab a bench, look around you, you can find a place, have a seat, let's talk about your life. I want to make sure before you leave this place that we deal with an issue. You know, we talked about sin tonight. It's a good subject to talk about. We talked about destiny. It's a good subject to talk about. And all of us have a destiny. There's a destination we're all headed to. We're all headed towards eternity. Did you know that you're an immortal being? You're going to live forever. And while we're here on the planet, we have an opportunity to choose with our life, because God is gracious and gives us the opportunity to choose with our lives where we go. Only going to go one or two places. Only going to live forever one or two places, either heaven or hell. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. You know, I don't think that's real. I think that's a fairy tale made up by parents to scare their children into being good. So I'm not going to go to hell. Well, did you know that all throughout the Bible it talks about hell? Old Testament, New Testament, Jesus talked about hell. It's a very real place. And just by saying you don't believe in hell's existence doesn't make it go away. That's like burying your head in the sand and expecting not to get touched by the wind. You're going to have to face the reality of it. Tonight, I want to make sure that you don't end up there. So I know you want to make sure you don't end up there, but listen, most of all, God loves you so much. He wants to make sure you don't go there. That's why we're talking about this right now. Let's talk about your eternal life. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I'm going to go to heaven because all roads lead to heaven. You know, you just do your thing. I'll do my thing. You know, we'll all make it there somehow, some way. The churches, they got their own ways, and that's all cool. God sees that and appreciates that. We'll all make it there somehow. But let's apply that logic to the earth for a second. What if I told you tonight, you know, all roads lead to the moon? You just drive around whatever road you choose, whatever they want to do or I want to do. We'll all make it to the moon somehow, some way. You'd say you're crazy. You could drive around the earth as long as you want. You'll never make it to the moon. So what makes us think that we can do whatever we want to do and we're going to make it to heaven? Doesn't work like that. Listen, Jesus came and he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. You know what that means? It means we can't get there your way. Can't get there my way. Can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. We got to get there one way, and that's God's way. Don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son Jesus, don't you think that after he goes to the cross, a beaten, bloody mess, public spectacle for all to see, don't you think he'd tell us how to get to heaven? Well, he does, right here in his word. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, that's good news because, you know, I've been a good person. Yeah, I used to be bad, cleaned up my act. I've been really good lately. In fact, I think I finally tipped the scales. My good outweighs my bad. God will see that, and God will let me into heaven because I've been good. Been nice to my neighbors, given money to charities, gotten involved in social justice causes, buying shoes that help kids in Africa, or buying water that digs wells in third world countries. I think that I've been good enough. But can I ask you a question? How good is good enough? Can you show me the scale in the Bible or the line you have to be above? Is there a curve or something that, you know, maybe if I'm not as good as that guy, but if I'm close to being as good as that guy, does that help me out with God? Where do you find that in the Bible? Because it's not there. You know what the Bible has to say about our goodness? It says it's like filthy rags to God. Going to get thrown out. Not going to get to stay. And the Bible tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We're not going to make it there based on our own merit or on our own goodness. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. Can't get to heaven just by being good. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, but I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. Born in America, America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. They hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck. Had you baptized or christened as a child. Attended religious classes like Sunday school or Sabbath school, maybe catechism class. We're not any of their religions. We're not Buddhists, Muslims, Hindus. That makes us Christians, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible? Check it out. Nowhere does it say. Parents raise you in church, tell you you're Christian, that makes you a Christian. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're born in America, you wear religious jewelry, you're baptized or christened as a child, or you attend religious classes, you get to go to heaven. I don't see anywhere in the Bible that it says because you're not some other religion that by default God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Come on, let's talk about your eternal life right now. What makes you think you're going to heaven? Sometimes people say, well, you know, I'm going to heaven not only because when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church in front of you right now. And I consider myself to be a Christian. That's great, but once again, let's apply some logic from the earth to that statement. What if I said, you know, I really would like to become a Dodger. And I went and I bought a Dodger uniform, brought my bat and my ball, thought that I was going to get to play in the game because I sat in the dugout there at Los Angeles, called myself a Dodger. Think I'm going to get to play in the game? No. They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out and lock me up. Why? Because I'm not a member of the Dodgers organization. And yet there's some very sobering passages of the Bible of people who were invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. They sat in a seat, and yet they weren't dressed the right way. And they said, friend, how did you get in here? They were cast out. Not everyone who sits in a church service and calls himself a Christian is a Christian according to what the Bible says. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, okay, I understand that, but you don't understand. My last church, I got involved. I helped out. I sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I taught in the Bible class. I even got a membership card. I could show it to you. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? Well, now we're back to good works, aren't we? Could you show me in the Bible where you help out in church, volunteer, sing in a choir, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions? People think of you as a leader. You get to go to heaven. God is not waiting at the gates of heaven looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter. It doesn't work like that. Somebody said, Pastor, okay, got you on this one. I know God. I celebrate the resurrection at Easter, sing the songs at Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures, Pastor. That's great. I'm glad you can do that. But could you show that to me in the Bible? You know who God is that gets you into heaven? You know, if you'd read your Bible, you'd know that demons know who Jesus is. They're not Christians headed for heaven. The devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. Everybody look up here at me for a second. Look up here. This is not what you have in your head that counts. Not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who he is, and that gets you right with God. Rather, this is about your heart. Jesus made a statement to a religious leader of his day who was a good guy, did a lot of good stuff, raised up, got involved in his church called the synagogue, taught others about God. He was a teacher of Israel. He was a good guy. And yet, when they're talking about this thing we're talking about, Jesus doesn't say, just keep doing what you're doing. Your good works will save you, or because you attended church, or because you were raised in church. He doesn't say any of that. What does Jesus say about getting into heaven? He says, you must be born again. That's simple. Not going to get there any other way. You must be born again. You say, well, what is being born again? Because I've seen that in movies and it's weird. I read about that on a blog or in a book or on the internet, something like that. Magazine article. I saw it on a TV show and I just didn't really like that and didn't think that I wanted any part of that. But now you're telling me that I have to do that? Yeah, because it's not what Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet say. It's what the Bible says. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. That's simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. In the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, a little up, a little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people who are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So tonight, let's do this God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. Tonight, your call, your choice. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and then pop my hands together just like this. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Okay? Now you might be thinking, whoa, wait a second. You're going to point at me and count and make me raise my hand in front of all these people? Pastor, hold on. Time out. I'll be embarrassed if I do that. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that. Think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? See, Pastor, I feel like you're pushing me. I am. You know why? Because the devil's pushing on the other side. He's trying to get you off this, trying to lie to you and tell you you don't need to do this. It's just emotions and fanaticism. It is not real. You're good enough. But remember, we talked how good is good enough. Only way that this is going to make it is if you do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'm a man. I'll see your hand go up, count it, put it right back down. Probably won't even be embarrassed. We're all friends here. We all love you. No one's judging, criticizing, or condemning. But even if you are embarrassed, better than ended up in hell for eternity, away from God. But on the other side of that coin, Jesus also said, if you deny me, I will deny you. Your call, your choice. I've done my job and loved you enough to tell you the truth. God's done his job sending Jesus, beaten bloody and hung on the cross. Now it's your turn. Will you give him all of your heart? Will you give him all of your life? Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of you, God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night. Make sure before you leave this place. Who should raise their hand? If you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, come on, I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know that's the condition of your heart. Little in, little out, little up, little down. Token prayer every now and then, like we talked about. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, if you're in the breezeways or wherever you're at within the sound of my voice, you can raise your hand and tell an usher coming to the church service right afterwards. Online, wherever you're at, God sees, God's right there with you. And if you raise your hand, you're saying something before God. Even though I'm not there, God sees. And then all you have to do is minimize your browser and click the blue button that says respond to God, and someone will lead you in a prayer, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and right on the homepage it says how to know God. Click that button. Someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. Thank you. There's one. There's two, three. Thank you. Four. God bless you. Who else tonight? Who else? We got four wise people already. Four wise people already. Help me out, ushers. If you see someone else, point them out for me. Anybody else real quick? We got four wise people already. I'm going to make sure. Anybody else real quick in this place? I'm going to wrap this up in a moment. I don't want you to miss out. If you know you need to do this, heart's pounding out of your chest and you're going, God, I know I need to. Come on, let's go for it. I didn't embarrass them and I won't embarrass you. Anybody else real quick? Just raise up high for me when I'm looking in your direction. I'm going to wrap this up. Anybody else? Come on, number five. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, let's go. Let's go for God tonight. You should. Where are you at? Just raise it up high. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right. Well, I know there's more, but I can't make you do it. I wish I could bend your arm behind your back and just kick you into heaven. Can't do that. You got to do this. It's your call. It's your choice. Let's celebrate those that did raise their hands. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise for four wise people. Hallelujah. All right. All four of you, and listen, the Lord just spoke to me. Five, six, seven, and eight. You didn't raise your hand, but you should have. It's not too late for you. We're all going to stand and give a clap, give a shout for you. All right, as we do, hold on, not yet. They're excited, all right? As we do, that's your cue to get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church. Get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front because we're going to change destinies tonight, okay? Get off the distraction of that old life and let's get on destiny with God, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Let's all stand now. You can clap and let's welcome them. Come on, you come right now. If you raise your hand or you should have raised your hand, come on down right now. They're coming. Let's give them a hand. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. From the family rooms, if you want to bring your children, come on down. This is your time right now. From the foyer, if you need to come in, come on in. This is your time right now. Hallelujah. All right. Hey, thank God you guys have come. Everybody up front, you guys don't have to kneel if you don't want to. Come on. All right. I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel waving at you. Really good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. He's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. He's going to give you some free information, some free literature, help you find out what to do next in your walk with God. Now that you're a Christian, what do I do? All right. Easy reading. It's free. And it'll just get you started in the right direction. All right. Then finally, he's going to introduce you to a friend we have here at the church we call a spiritual personal trainer. They'll come alongside you for a couple weeks, teach you some things out of the Bible, help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back to the old man distracted, right? Now you go on with the new man on purpose, right? Living out your destiny. An SPT or a friend in church will help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. So if you guys are going to make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.